Hi, I'm Professor Tom Solomon. I'm Professor of Neurology at the University of Liverpool and the Walton Neurocentre in Liverpool, and I'm President of the Encephalitis Society. Encephalitis is inflammation and swelling of the brain, and it's quite often caused by a virus. And the most common viral cause of encephalitis around the world, the most common sporadic cause, is herpes simplex virus. Herpes simplex virus is a very common virus. About 70% of people have been infected by it. And in most people, it just lives in a nerve at the back of the nose and then occasionally comes down and causes cold sores, and people are familiar with that. But in an unfortunate small number of people, instead of coming down and causing a cold sore around the mouth, the virus goes the other way up into the brain and causes, if you like, a cold sore on the brain. And that's what inflammation and swelling in the brain is. That's what herpes encephalitis is. When patients are first ill with herpes encephalitis, they may just have a flu-like illness. It may be a fever, headaches, they may be achy. It may seem like any other flu, and patients may want to take to their bed. But the clue that this is something more serious than that is that patients may become confused or muddled, or they may even behave strangely. Now, sometimes this means that patients are thought to have psychiatric illness and enter the psychiatric services. But that confusion and strange behaviour often then progresses so that they actually become drowsy, they may have convulsions, children especially are more likely to have convulsions, and they may slip into coma. And all these things together make it quite clear that this is a patient who has a serious brain problem, a brain infection, and needs to get medical attention as soon as possible. The way we diagnose any form of encephalitis is usually with a lumbar puncture and a brain scan. The lumbar puncture is when we pop a needle in between the bones of the vertebrae to get some of the spinal fluid, cerebrospinal fluid. This is the fluid that washes the brain. And in that fluid, we can tell if there's inflammation, if there are inflammatory cells there that shouldn't be there. And then ultimately, we can do tests for the actual cause of that inflammation, such as a PCR test, a polymerase chain reaction test, for herpes simplex virus. Then we usually also do a brain scan, and this is another way of seeing if there is inflammation and swelling in the brain. We treat herpes simplex virus encephalitis with an antivirus drug called acyclovir, and we've been using this for about 30 or 40 years. And what we've shown over the last few years in our research in conjunction with the Encephalitis Society is that patients were often being treated late with this drug, because doctors and nurses were failing to recognise the disease. But over the last 10 years or so, we've improved that, and now patients get on treatment much quicker and they have better outcomes. But still, even when patients do get this acyclovir treatment quickly, still the outcomes are sometimes not as good as we'd like them to be. And one of the big questions which we're answering at the moment with a big research study across the UK is whether giving the anti-inflammatory drug dexamethasone will actually improve the outcome even further by reducing the brain swelling. Some patients with herpes simplex virus encephalitis do very well. They get on the treatment very quickly, and the treatment seems to stop the swelling and stop the virus replicating. They might feel very unwell for a few days. Typically, they're treated for 2 to 3 weeks with drugs, but eventually they get back home, get back to work, if they're working, get back to a normal life. But sadly, that's not the case for all patients, and many patients are left with, particularly with memory problems, short-term memory problems, because that's the part of the brain that's affected by herpes encephalitis. And then sadly, some patients do die of this condition, although thankfully, with the research that we've been doing at the University of Liverpool and through the Encephalitis Society and with the help of many others over the last 10 to 15 years, those numbers have dropped.